we got together a couple of weeks ago for the first time because we are really interested as 42 as a new software engineering school to help develop a curriculum around what digital skills, what are the aspects of software engineering and designing and developing mobile ecosystems that we should teach at our school. Now, Android Auto is an environment that is very interesting for us, for our students to learn. What do you think might be components and aspects that we should stress as we're thinking about training the next generation software engineers?
I guess there's a couple of things that, you know, I feel are important, kind of like more as kind of like general disciplines to like learn, understand, and, you know, like, you know, constantly keep learning about those, but like, you know, have like be equipped with a good understanding of those. Also, you know, teaching skills around how to work with this data, how to use machine learning, artificial intelligence, like building those kind of like self-working systems, as I might call it. One thing would be kind of like, you know, systems thinking, like, you know, think in bigger, like learn how to build and design bigger systems and, you know, scalability, like how to scale systems, like, you know, like this type of thinking. You cannot just build one isolated pilot, you know, application or whatever, but you have to get at this from a, you know, from a systems level perspective. Like, you know, this has to grow, this has to interact with other systems, this has to scale, this has to be resilient. Like this type of thinking, I guess is crucial for the next generation of, you know, of like of students that you have, of, you know, software engineers that will build these ecosystems and, you know, these also then these applications on top of it. They need to have this type of understanding.
Is it fair to say that, you know, architect for scalability so that this is what you're building works in, you know, in a few use cases, but it also works if, you know, the world is picking up on it and all of a sudden you have a million users. Is that the kind of thinking you're describing?
Yes, you know, probably even more than, I guess, than a million users. I guess, like, you know, from experience, and, you know, you know, as well as I do, from also experience at Google, you know, like it's very different if you build something, a service that serves a couple of thousand or 100,000 users, and then you go to a million or a billion and you roll this out to a global service. Like a lot of things happen, and, you know, the more the bigger and the more complex systems get, you know, the more complex the interactions inside the systems get, and then things are harder to predict, and you want to build in this resilience into those systems that they, you know, can scale even then. Yeah. I think what's usually really a driving factor and will be a driving factor in the future is built on kind of like open source, open standards. Like building something on very proprietary systems is something that's hard to scale. You know, there's some examples, of course, which usually are the exceptions to the rule, that you can do this, but it's very hard to do. And I think in a much more interconnected world, and especially in the mobility world, that we'll have to interconnect a lot of players, only, you know, building on top of open platforms and using open systems, open source software, and these kind of things is what will make this successful.
Hi, Jens. I'm super happy to welcome you to the third episode of 42X, the speaker series where we do deep dives with interesting people from the digital ecosystem. And I'm very happy that we got you today. Do you want to introduce yourself and how you came to meet us?
Cool. Max, thanks for having me. You know, pleasure to be on the podcast and, you know, having this chat with you. So thanks for the introduction. As you said, my name is Jens Bussmann. I'm currently with Google looking after our partnerships with European OEMs around all things Android for cars. So how to bring Android and the Android ecosystem into cars. I've been with Google for over 9.5 years so far. so quite some history with the company. I'm on the Android side now for about 2 years, and you know, working on building this ecosystem in the automotive world. Before that, I've been with the cloud team and building, helping to build our cloud business in the German-speaking markets for about 6 years. And you know, right before joining Google, I've been with another enterprise IT company called Cisco, which I spent another 7 years with. And this is kind of like my quick journey through the IT industry, and then ending up with, you know, Android and the partnership with automotive players in the automotive industry that we're doing today.
Very cool. And as you can tell already, Jens knows a bit about ecosystems and how to get different partners together, how to work with across different cultures, right? I know Siemens, Bosch, BMW are companies that you've also been working with, and you also know the other side of the Atlantic. So really interested to hear your thoughts about how the Android Auto ecosystem is set up and how it will develop. But I always start with the question, Jens, what question should I be asking? How would you like to frame the conversation that we have on this podcast?
Cool. So probably like the one question I also always get, which is, I guess, probably the best one to get started with, is, why is Google, why is Android looking for like cars? Like, you know, why do you do this thing? Like, what's your plan? You know, what's the background behind bringing Android into cars, into vehicles? Like, what's the bigger picture? That's probably a good thing to start with, I guess.
A really good starting point, because you could argue that you know, Google is already everywhere. Why does it need to be in the cars too?
Yes, probably right. And as I said, you know, sometimes you know, I get this type of question. You know, and I can start giving a little bit of background on, you know, how this all came about and how we started doing these things. So, you know, in general, like as Google, we've been partnering with the automotive industry since, I don't know, more than a decade, 15 years plus on different things. But one thing we've started to see, like, you know, when smartphones came about and people got the smartphones and got into the using their smartphones as their daily devices, something that we've recognized is that people want to be connected and use digital services in their digital life, like the things that they do day in and day out, also when they're in the car, like not just when they're at home or when they're in the bus or at work and using their smartphone, but also in the car. To a point where this becomes really not the most safest way of conducting your vehicle, you know, doing chat messaging, other stuff on your smartphone while driving. And this was the point when we thought, okay, there must be a better way. And we thought, oh, technology, actually, there must be technology there that we have, you know, at our disposal that we can use to make this a better experience. And then in general, we looked at our experience from the past, and something that we generally found is, if you look at complex problems and if you look at how to drive innovation, something that we've learned, you know, over the last 15, 20 years is that if you have platforms and ecosystems, this is what really helps driving complex computational problems to resolutions and drives innovation, because ecosystems is usually something that creates virtuous cycles. And open ecosystems are the most powerful ones. Like closed ecosystems are good to be there, but open ecosystems are much more powerful than closed ones. And then ecosystems usually only work very well when they're positioned on top of a platform. Like if you don't have like a real good platform, ecosystems usually don't develop. And then we've also experienced that open platforms, again, are the most powerful ones. If you have a very closed platform, ecosystems don't kind of like grow that fast and that quickly as you want them. And open platforms really, really help with this. And then finally, something that we have learned is, even though you might have an open platform, something that really helps is those open platforms need to be embedded or implemented in kind of products. They need to be embodied in products and services. So you need to have like a lighthouse showcase that shows like, this is the power of the platform, this is the power of the ecosystem, and then you start the cycle. And you know, with this background, we've looked at the experience and we were like, okay, like where have we seen this before? And we're like, okay, you know, we have seen this also play out in mobile. So, you know, mobile before iOS and Android was very fragmented ecosystem, different operating system, different players, not a lot of innovation, you could argue, that was happening because it was so fragmented. And then iOS and Android kind of came along and brought two platforms with ecosystems packed on top of them, which enabled and, you know, drove a lot of upcoming innovation in, you know, in the last decade, you know, since 2007, 2008, roughly. And, you know, let me get back to this ecosystems drive those virtuous cycles of innovation. Like when we look at this, we look at this ecosystem as, you know, several parts that you know, make this ecosystem. You know, we look at one side is kind of like the manufacturer, the device builder, like the ones that do the physical device. Right. And then we look at the users that want to use this device. And then we look at also the developers, like the folks that build digital services. And you know, you have this virtuous cycle because device builders don't build devices if users don't buy them. Like they want to offer something to potential customers that they really want to acquire, they really want to use and are really attracted to. And those users usually look for different digital services, like things they can do with this device, which is what developers usually provide and build. And those developers want to build, they want an easy way to build on a standard platform so they don't have to build it over and over again because they want to reach a lot of users. And the more standardized this is, and the more open, the easier for developers. You get more developers, you get more services, more users buy more devices, more happy manufacturers, you know, and you start this cycle. And we've seen this with Android, and then we thought, wait, this worked on mobile for Android. Like, this might also work actually with cars. Like, it's not too different an analogy. Like, people want those services in the cars. That's what we've seen. So why don't we bring Android into those cars and try to start the same ecosystem and virtuous cycle inside cars? And kind of like, this is a very long, you know, story over 7-8 years that we've been doing this, try to like cramp into a couple of minutes to explain like how we came about to bring Android into cars. So in essence, you know, the idea is bring this ecosystem to drive innovation, you know, for the next generation of, you know, vehicles.
Very cool. Now, I remember back in the day when we started Android and we were thinking about bringing the best experience to users, we partnered with HTC to build, you know, hardware that was really gave the best user experience that Android could offer. And then later we started to, Google started to build their own phones, the Pixels, and this is kind of a good case to look at how Android can be at its best. Do we have a partner or several partners that you think have done a particularly good job in bringing Android Auto and the services into the car? And also, I'd love if you could do a little bit of myth-busting, because I think there are some misconceptions about what Android Auto is and what the goals are. So two questions, where is it at its best? And what are some of the myths that people have about Android Auto?
Yeah, so maybe let me start with like the myth-busting first, or like, you know, giving a little bit of more background on this. So because something that we've maybe not been that good at is kind of like confusing in naming services or products that we have. So we have several things that are called similarly but do different things. So when we thought of how can we bring Android and the Android ecosystem inside cars, like we started with something that was kind of like a quick win, which is what we call today Android Auto, which is an app on your smartphone that lets you connect your smartphone to an infotainment system inside the car. So more or less like mirror your smartphone onto the infotainment screen in the car, like making it simpler to bring your apps in. This is a very, very low level, very, very simple integration. I should say, with the vehicle, with the car. And it's mainly driven by, you know, like the two OEM and the two OS providers. Like Apple has something similar with CarPlay, like how you can bring, right, you know, like the Apple ecosystem into the car. And it's very much a Apple or Google forward type of experience that you bring, because like you just mirror your smartphone, whatever's on your smartphone and how this looks like, you bring to the car. And then the second step that we thought is, but this is just a very superficial integration. So let's look at something more. And this is where we started the second pillar, let's say, the second stage of how to bring Android and the ecosystem inside cars. It's what we call Android Automotive OS. This is the Android operating system, an extension of the mobile side of the operating system with functionality and features that are needed inside a car to fully replace the operating system that is used inside cars for the infotainment stack. So your full infotainment system can run on Android as the operating system built in, which gives you much deeper possibilities for integration, which gives much deeper possibilities for the OEMs, the car manufacturers, to tweak it to their wishes, you know, like the HMI, the UX, all these kind of things, like to make it much more of an, let's say, of an OEM forward experience. Like the OEM has much, much more control now over the operating system and can build this, but it's still standard Android. So, you know, all the security patches that, you know, Google does for the ecosystem, like once a month, all the updates each year, next Android version, like all of these things, you get all of these benefits. You know, you just upgrade Android. You don't have to develop your own operating system anymore from scratch. And then third, we thought, okay, now we need to bring something into the vehicle as well that, you know, makes it that users might want, that users might love, which we thought of. There is some Google services that now you can build on top of this, which is Google Maps for navigation, for example, inside the car, or the Play Store for downloading apps, or the Google Assistant for voice control and these kind of things. So, you know, we started with just mirroring your phone, then building the full operating system, and then also offering Google services on top of that, that you can install inside the car and run. So we do these three things, and they're very different from an implementation perspective. And there's very different levels of control for a car maker. Like not so much for just projecting your phone, because it's driven by the phone experience, a lot more of control and, you know, customization if it's the operating system itself. Because you take the operating system and then you can do with it kind of like what you wish. And this is sometimes getting confused, I guess, super like by people. And then to the other part of your question.
Super helpful. Thank you.
Yes, and to your other part of the question, like, and that's what you think, like, when I mentioned, like, these open platforms need to be embodied, like, you need this kind of, like, lead device, or whatever you want to call it, like, the one we did with HTC, like, you know, with the G1, and these kind of things. So this is what we have started now with the first partners, and Volvo Polestar currently is our, like, kind of, like, launch partner, like, our HTC on, like, equivalent to the smartphone world, if you wish. So in the Polestar 2 is kind of like the first vehicle that uses Android as the operating system for the infotainment system, fully customized by Polestar, their HMI, their ideas, how to implement this inside a car. And then it also brings as a lead device, left Google services front and center in the car. Like it brings Google Maps for navigation. It brings the Google Assistant to control the car to like showcase what you could do, like what, you know, what an implementation of the platform plus the ecosystem could look like. And this is like the first device with which we can show this with our partners, you know, like to the users and, you know, see what they think of it. And we've started other partnerships with GM in the US, with Renault and Nissan as well. And we will see more of those devices, which will roll out and which will be different implementations of the same type of platform and ecosystem, but, you know, gives you very different flavors and ways of how, you know, users will see an end result. So we have this embodiment of the platform. And maybe very last point, I think very different to smartphones, cars are much, much more complex products than a smartphone. And I don't think there's any plan in the future that there will be kind of like a Pixel car by Google or something like this. I don't think this makes sense. This is such a complex business. This is very much more a business of, you know, where you really need to partner. You know, it's even smartphones are hard to do on your own. And we also, you know, very much value the partnerships that we have there. And it's it's a little bit easier maybe on the mobile side to do a showcase smartphone, but it's very hard to do a showcase smartphone or a showcase car without your partners. So in all these cases, like, partnerships are the thing to go on in the automotive world for us.
Thanks, Jens. Now, you brought up the lead cases, and one myth, one thought that I hear from the automotive world is, oh, you know, we shouldn't do this because, you know, then Google gets access to all our data and we're losing control. What do you answer to those questions?
Yes, it's, you know, it's I guess, like, the same question is coming up, not just for automotive, but, you know, across several industries. In general, the way we treat this across Google and across different products is that usually if any data is only provided from a device to a Google application with consent of the user. So, you know, an application, like, you know, technically speaking, the way this works, an application has to ask for permissions, and those permissions need to be granted by the user. You know, as you might know, like, from your smartphone, you know, an application that needs camera access to, I don't know, scan your environment or whatsoever, first needs to ask you for permission. You have to grant that permission, and then kind of like the data can be transferred only if the user does so. So this works exactly the same also inside cars. You know, a user has to grant permission, and OEMs can do exactly the same with their apps. And that's the idea, you know, like, that's the philosophy that we have behind this platform. So, you know, there's not just Google apps, there's also OEM apps, and we want to enable car makers to build great services that they can offer to the users, to the drivers. And, you know, via these services, they can also collect the necessary data to improve those services, make those services better. I don't know, like, you could build your own parking apps, your own charging apps, your, I don't know, your aftermarket, you know, repair, maintenance apps, all these kind of things. And the idea is to make it so simple with Android as an operating system, an open source layer, to build those apps and have those apps get access to the different data points if the user gives permission for those, that it's much easier and much more scalable as it is today for a car maker to even build those apps. Like, our experience is today, you know, if you want to bring those digital services as a car maker into your cars, it's usually a one-off thing that you build. It's really hard to do. It doesn't scale very well. If you go to the next generation of car or of infotainment system, you have to rebuild it again. So you start the whole cycle again. They're not really compatible. Like, you know, we want to make this much, much simpler and much, much easier. So, you know, like, in essence, the idea is to give them more control and more possibilities to extract more value from the vehicles and build more of those services themselves.
Okay, that makes a lot of sense. And then I guess the other and last point about the current state, because I do want to have a chat about the future as well. But the last question for the current state is, you mentioned the three player ecosystem, right? The car manufacturer, mm-hmm. the ecosystem provider, and the developers, right? Really importantly. So also for the developers, if you are a Spotify or you know, another app provider, of course, it's much more attractive to build for a whole ecosystem that will be using a whole variety of car makers that will be using the operating system and build once and deploy on a variety of devices. But is it the case that you have to develop for Android Auto and that environment in particular, right? It's not, you can't take your normal Android app and just say, make that available on in cars as well, I assume. Or is that another myth that I'm bringing up?
it's not a full myth. It's part myth, part truth, probably.
Okay.
So you cannot just take your phone app and bring your phone app into the car. Like, this doesn't work. Like, the developers need to do some adaptations to their app and some refactoring of the app, which is not a lot of effort. So, you know, we've worked with a couple of developers that have, like, refactored their app when we launched the Polestar 2 and, like, brought those app into the Polestar 2. And, you know, effort ranges between 1 to 2 weeks to 1 to 2 months of, like, refactoring word per ad. You know, it depends on the complexity of the app, of course, but it's, you know, there is some effort that you have to do, but it's not a lot. And we kind of like have, we see this as a, as one of the hurdles for developers, like in general, in the automotive industry, like usually mobile developers are used to deploy their app to hundreds of millions, if not billions of devices or users, like build once and roll out to hundreds of millions of devices and installs. And volumes are, you know, much, much lower in the automotive world than they are in the mobile world. So for them, it's a hurdle to build something bespoke for just, you know, car manufacturer A and maybe something different for car manufacturer B, and, you know, justify the effort that gets into this. And this is what we're trying to address. And even more so, what we're trying to build in is also a way for them to make it simple for their apps to bring them into vehicles based on templates, as we call them, which right. means, you know, taking the example of Spotify, Spotify builds an app once, but what we've seen in cars, different to smartphones and very different to smartphones, cars, at least what we see today, will have very different types of displays, surfaces, like, you know, wide screen, portrait screen, rounded screens, you know, very wide screens, all these kind of things. And we want to make it simple for developers to build one and then have the system render those apps in the right format for the right screen via those templates. Because, you know, the thing that developers want is something's quick and easy to build. I build it once, and the potential user base I get is across a lot of, you know, a lot of hardware providers, let's say, in this case, a lot of car manufacturers. And, you know, and then they will invest a lot, and then they will drive innovation and bring new features that only make sense in a car. Like right now, they're, you know, up to today, they've not really looked at this, because, you know, driving innovation for specifically for the car use case is not worth the effort, like, you know, to be a little bit sarcastic, for a developer today. But this is what we're trying to change, like to bring more of that innovation to the cars.
Very cool. Thanks. I think now we have a good overview of where we stand, and also a little bit where you want to go. But I'd like to make that point a little bit more explicit. So thinking about where we want to go, what is your vision when we're talking mobility ecosystems and the technology in it, when we go relatively far out, right? Let's get out of the logins that we're in today. And so you probably want to pick 20 years or 50 years or even 100 years. How should our ecosystem look like? What are the components and what are the elements that make it attractive for the various stakeholders, and especially, you know, good flow for the user, good flow of traffic for all of us that we need to get around?
Yeah, so, you know, probably like, you know, really predicting far out into the future is probably one of the hardest things ever to do, I guess.
Of course, that's why I ask you.
Especially,
yes.
I know. And, you know, and probably especially for like the mobility type of ecosystem, because there's so many different things going on. I guess like my personal view on, you know, probably like 30, 40, 50-ish years out, because like, you know, it's like the mobility world and the automotive world is like, it's not a world where things change over the course of 12 months, like a lot of things, like it's much longer cycles. You know, it's probably a couple of decades that we would look at. But I guess in general, I think the concept of mobility will change. And I think most people will probably also agree on this. I've guessed that for most, in most countries, in, you know, both like mature countries as well as like emerging countries, it will be much more of kind of like mobility as a service type of concept. Like you get your mobility when you need it. Like this will be driven by technology. I totally believe into this. I guess there will still be a sort of kind of like personal ownership of mobility. You know, like people still want to own their personal type of, you know, space, their personal type of vehicle or way to be mobile. I guess so, like this will not go away. Like we will not live in a world where there is only kind of like mobility on demand by driverless shuttles or this kind of thing. I don't see this as the only thing. There will still be like personal ownership, and potentially there will still be an option to like even drive by yourself. There's things that people like, there's a lot of emotion in the mobility world as well. Like people like to drive things. And I guess like this will not go away quickly. This will still stay. I also think in the mobility world, we'll probably move away from just fossil fuels. You know, I don't think that fossil fuels will stay here forever. Like we will move away from this as kind of like, you know, the underlying way of, you know, how we generate the energy for mobility. And then I think the overall systems that we'll see will be deeply integrated with kind of like, I don't know, whatever you want to call this, like the living spaces, the cities, or also the urban and rural kind of areas. Like, you know, they will not be isolated in silos and detached as they are today. There will be much more communication between infrastructure, vehicles, people, all these kind of things will be more interconnected to, you know, like optimize mobility and make sure that, you know, things happen when they should happen, move people in the right way to the right location, optimize for, I don't know, traffic and congestion, optimize for whatever other things you want to optimize for in an environment. But, you know, these things will be much more interconnected. I don't think these are all things that my team, like, or like what I'm working on will be looking at. Like we'll look at a very, very niche part of this, which is kind of like, you know, giving the user, you know, their connected services that they want. And for this, I think we can look at a much shorter time frame, maybe the next 5 to 10 years. Nice. And if we look at this very limited area, I guess what our vision is, what we think might happen is that these lines between, you know, digital devices, a smartphone, devices in your home, the car, these will all blend and be kind of become more like ambient type of things. So like the idea is, you know, when you enter a vehicle, all your personal services, all your personal content, your preferences will be synced automatically to this device. They will be there without you like doing anything. You know, our vision is that you get all these different types of services that you have on your phone. Also, when you're in your car, you know, there's no need for you to even look or think about your phone anymore. Like we're not there yet. Like this is a 5-10 years type of thing, but kind of like think of it, your digital identity comes with you. And also for privacy reasons, you know, we think not all of these things will run on every single device. Like some things will be on your personal device, always with you. And this content will not leave your device. Just the projection of the content might move. And, you know, we will see this blending of things, you know, but, you know, probably this is also a decade out. Like, you know, we usually underestimate how long it takes to get this started, but we overestimate also sometimes like the bigger changes and how long those take. But I guess like, you know, 10 years from now, like, you know, your digital services will just be with you and they will be on different surfaces at your fingertips. And you will just not know where they're coming from, but you will know that what's personal to you will be stored very personally on your personal type of device, but you can still interact with those services. And I don't think we'll make differences between cars and other types of interaction platforms, let's say.
Okay, other parts of the mobility ecosystem. Yeah, makes a lot of sense. Now, I'm with you. I'm in that world. How did we get there? There is a method called backcasting. You first think about where you want to go, you know, the environment, the conditions that you want to have, and then you think about the different steps that have to happen to get to that scenario. Are there some particular developments that you see, maybe some stakeholders getting together, organizing to give you one example, but you're welcome to choose something completely different. You said, you know, all these different actors have to interoperate in this environment that you describe, right? Is that something that you see already on its way? And if so, where, or, you know, what are aspects that we need to look at to make this happen?
Yeah, I think this is still like very immature, like at the very, very beginning of seeing this happening. You know, if you do like kind of like this backcasting and like look at what are the steps that need to happen, I guess like one of the first steps that needs to happen is that even though we want to have this one system eventually, like we probably have to look at different areas first. Like what we're trying to look at is kind of like the in-car area first. Like the idea is, you know, to have a common standard platform across the industry where people can build on top of it to make it easier for people to drive different services and innovation. This is kind of like the one part inside the vehicle to make this easier. The other thing is probably if you look at, you know, infrastructure, like the peripherals around it, it's probably also another area where we would, as you know, as an industry or, you know, as society or I don't know, whatever you want, like have to look at and say, how can we create a standard, a platform there that has like, you know, infrastructure talk to each other for now. And then probably the next area is what's an easy way in a first step on which we can iterate to have, you know, like the mobile assets talk to the immobile assets, you know, like, you know, a standard how to communicate over 5G and all these kind of things to get this started. And we'll probably see a couple of those initiatives. And I personally believe one of the things that's hard to do is have all those initiatives, but also make sure that you don't have too many of those initiatives competing with each other. Because, you know, you will probably not be fast enough and successful if everybody tries to create their own platform, their own standards. Like we need some kind of, you know, I don't want to call it a consortium, but, you know, a broader partnership of different players that want to go into the same direction and not everybody trying to build their own type of platform and ecosystem. Because, you know, in different areas, history has shown like this doesn't work. Like experience shows, you know, there if the ecosystem is too small, it will not thrive and you will not create like critical mass for it.
Yeah,
and I guess these will be the steps.
Super interesting. As you probably know, I've been working with Vin Cerf, who embedded TCP/IP about 50 years ago, I guess now. And so he has been part of that whole story of how the internet became this innovation engine and that open platform that we're all learning from as we're developing new platforms. And I think, you know, looking at institutions like the Internet Engineering Task Force and similar places, maybe the W3C, the World Wide Web Consortium, you know, that's an interesting, interesting institutions because they balance the need for resilience, right? For something that actually works, as well as the speed that open collaboration offers. I've been working with Vint on IoT interoperability for quite a while when I was in the States, and it's so difficult to get these obviously competing players to think together and move together for the better good. And I hope and I do believe that Google can be a facilitator in these type of conversations with platforms like Android, but also cloud. In this regard. Now, Jens, we got together a couple of weeks ago for the first time because we are really interested as 42, as a new software engineering school, to help develop a curriculum around what digital skills, what are the aspects of software engineering and designing and developing mobile ecosystems that we should teach at our school. Now, Android Auto is an environment that is very interesting for us, for our students to learn. What do you think might be components and aspects that we should stress as we're thinking about training the next generation software engineers?
Okay. It's a big task, I would say. I'll try to, you know, I'll give it a shot. Like what I might think. So I guess there's a couple of things that, you know, I feel are are important, kind of like more as kind of like general disciplines to like learn, understand, and, you know, like, you know, constantly keep learning about those, but like, you know, have like be equipped with a good understanding of those.
Perfect.
If I, this is really, you know, good. If I pick like what, four or five, yeah, if I pick four or five of those, I guess like one thing would be kind of like, you know, systems thinking, like, you know, think in bigger, like learn how to build and design bigger systems and, you know, scalability, like how to scale systems, like, you know, like this type of thinking, is because I truly believe that this is one of the things that you will need in the mobility world. Like you cannot just build one isolated pilot, you know, application or whatever, but you have to get at this from a, you know, from a systems level perspective. Like, you know, this has to grow, this has to interact with other systems, this has to scale, this has to be resilient. Like this type of thinking, I guess is crucial for the next generation of, you know, of like, of students that you have, of, you know, software engineers that will build these ecosystems and, you know, these also then these applications on top of that. They need to have this type of understanding of thinking. Okay.
Is it fair to say that, you know, architect for scalability, so that this is what you're building works in you know, in a few use cases, but it also works if you know, the world is picking up on it and all of a sudden you have a million users. Is that the kind of thinking you're describing?
Yes, you know, probably even more than I guess than a million users. I guess, like, you know, from experience, and, you know, you know as well as I do, from also experience at Google, you know, like it's very different if you build something, a service that serves a couple of thousand or 100,000 users, and then you go to a million or a billion and you roll this out to a global service. Like a lot of things happen, and, you know, the more the bigger and the more complex systems get, you know, the more complex the interactions inside the systems get, and then things are harder to predict, and you want to build in this resilience into those systems that they, you know, can scale even then. Yeah, and then I would say, like, another one that's important is, you know, teaching and learning in, like, using open platforms, open source systems. Like, I think what's usually really a driving factor and will be a driving factor in the future is built on kind of like open source, open standards. Like, building something on very proprietary systems is something that's hard to scale. You know, there's some examples, of course, which usually are the exceptions to the rule, that you can do this, but it's very hard to do. And I think in a much more interconnected world, and especially in the mobility world, that we'll have to interconnect a lot of players, only, you know, building on top of open platforms and using open systems, open source software, and these kind of things is what will make this successful. That will be the second thing, like looking at open platforms, open source software, and so on. Of course, all of these things will be data driven. You know, like, you know, the more data you have, the more you can work with this data, you will optimize, you will make this better interactions of those systems. So also, you know, teaching skills around how to work with this data, how to use machine learning, artificial intelligence, like building those kind of like self-working systems, as I might call it.
Yeah, self-optimizing.
Is probably one thing that you would, you know, you would want to put a focus on from my perspective. Because like there's no way that without, you know, those self-optimizing machine learning AI type of tools, you know, we will be in a position to make sense of all this data and optimize for that. Like things will just have so much data, things will just develop so quickly that without a systemic help, you know, we will not be able to make use of it. So I think this is a critical skill for the next 50 plus years to build on top of that. And then the last like one, two type of skills, I guess, important specifically for the mobility world is skill sets around IoT. You know, like this is very specific type of use cases, scenarios, protocols, interactions that are different sometimes to standard software engineering that you would think of if you write at type of, you know, standard applications. And I think this is extremely critical for a mobility type of environment. And on top of that, or overarching, you know, security, cybersecurity, because, you know, these systems will be everywhere. They will be embedded in a lot of things, and they will be prone to attacks, to vulnerabilities. And I think a extremely critical skill set for anyone that goes through your school and, you know, will have, you know, kind of like good chances, or like a very open career path, is also somebody who is like, who understands security, you know, across domain, you know, and not just on one specific topic, like, you know, how to secure operating system XYZ, but how to secure a system, how to secure an, you know, cross domain type of attack surface. I think that's also a very critical skill that we will see in much, much more need in the next 20 years than we do see today, even though we already see this today, but this will be even much more critical going forward.
Yeah, I always say security is the weakest link game, right? So the more complex the environment gets that you're securing, you really have to think about the whole surface and reducing that and breaking it down into different layers of security. It's fascinating stuff. I remember in an earlier conversation, you had also mentioned the as an organization, there is a difference between you know, the development in other industries, traditional engineering, and you know, coming up with a software engineering mindset where you're you know, releasing, learning, iterating, and developing a bit faster. Is that something that we could also include in the training at our school, or you think you have to do that in the practice of a big organization? Something that is learned and practiced in companies.
It's probably both. You know, I mean, because I guess like you, it should. I guess probably in the school, my assumption would be this is kind of like the air you breathe every day. It's kind of like part of the culture anyways, to be like agile and, you know, iterative and, you know, fast moving type of environment. But, you know, fostering this culture and this thinking, I think, is important, because to get this into organizations that are not used to it, to change that culture, like you need to bring in this fresh air, this new blood, whatever you want to call it, that brings with it this thinking. So you're like, you really have to, like, I think, embody this in the people that go through your school, to make them ambassadors, let's say, in those organizations. I guess for a lot of organizations, like generally, it has already made kind of like click that this is the way to do things, but it's not easy to change. You know, it's a lot of effort. It's a lot of things that need to work differently. And also some things might have to be like reinvented from scratch to like really adapt to this world. Like it's not like minor changes that you have to do, but sometimes it's bigger efforts. But this is probably what's necessary, because, like, you know, even if this sounds kind of like cheesy, but, you know, we all know, like, the only constant in the world is change, and, you know, change is accelerating. Like you have to be, you know, faster, and you have to be able to adapt quickly and change things. And I think just yesterday, and, you know, and I know, like, in the automotive industry, this is probably something that people are like sick of hearing. But I read another article about, you know, this EV startup from California that, you know, is building this factory in Germany right now. So, you know, like, for example, one thing I've read about Tesla, like, everybody talks about Tesla and software and how they do this iterative approach and like OTA updates and all these kind of things. But what I've read was an interesting article that said that also some part of the mechanical part of the vehicle, it seems that they have iterated on this mechanical part over the production of a couple of months of the Model 3. So even a Model 3 that went from the production line from month 1 to month 8 or whatever had 14 different iterations of this part inside the car, because they optimized even this, which is nothing that you would do in a traditional way in the automotive industry. Like, you design one, you make the run, and then once the first generation run is over, then you do the next generation run. But it's, you know, it's fixed for this time frame. You know, if it's a good concept or not to do this in the physical world, you know, I'm not the expert to judge, But like, this is the kind of thinking that I think you have to ingrain into the students, you know, at your school, that a disrespect, you know, for like the impossible, and challenging the status quo. That's, you know, that's probably what's an important part as well.
Very cool, Jens. So let me say that we would love to have you and others from the Android Auto world come and share your knowledge with our students, come and help us develop that curriculum for software engineering, automotive and mobility ecosystems. We now have an official way to get that organized. Since last Friday, we have fellowships, and we would love to have some fellows from your environment. We'd love to have fellows from, of course, the Volkswagen environment, the automotive industry, to come together, because as you say, it's kind of a joint effort from a variety of different experts and different expertise that needs to come together. As you mentioned, these fellows are also people that bring that mindset and bring that culture that you have been describing to the companies, together with the students that will be entering into these organizations. And I think that's really half what this is about, right? Changing the mindset to a more collaborative environment, to give every player the understanding where they are in control and where it's just natural to be part of a global environment that is not controlled by any single player. I read a piece about conspiracy theories, and one common theme of conspiracy theories is that, you know, there is one entity that is in control, and this can really be dispelled. No single entity is in control of any aspect these days, because it's just too big, right? The world is very big and is very complex. So it's really a matter of collaborating, of cooperating, of being in competition and being in cooperation in most scenarios. And I think, for me as a philosopher, it's always not knowing that produces the fear, right? So the better you understand a certain environment, the more open the conversations between the different stakeholders are, the better the results for everybody, and the easier it is to move forward. So in that sense, Jens, thank you for doing us the service of understanding better the Android Auto perspective, and for being here in this learning environment. I hope you enjoyed the conversation a bit, and that we will have you back, and that we develop a good cooperation in the next coming month and years.
All right, you know, Max, thanks a lot for having me, for the invitation. It was a pleasure as always. Happy to share, happy to be back. It was a lot of fun. Thank you.